There was once a country called Love Songylvania. And in this country of Love Songylvania, everyone was engaged in writing love songs, composing love songs. Why did I look at him? publishing love songs, exporting them. But most of all, everyone in Love Songylvania went around singing love songs to each other. The boy sang a pretty love song to a girl, and the girl sang a pretty love song back to the boy. And this was their whole life, singing about love. And one day, one citizen of Love Songylvania was walking down the business district of town, down the sidewalk, and he was in a very sad, depressed mood. And the reason he was in a sad mood is because a couple of months before, he'd broken up with his girlfriend. And because he didn't come to this class, as he walked down the sidewalk, the imaginary pictures of the beautiful romance he'd had with this girl went through his mind over and over, and every time it did, it made him more sad than before. And he remembered how they sat in the moonlight and sang love songs to each other and vowed eternal devotion and all the rest of it. And now that was no more. So in this sad mood, he walked down the street and reflected upon the folly of Love Songylvania, how everyone talked about love, how they told each other that they cared, and no one really did. And he saw that how much fakery there was in human relations, especially when they talked about caring for each other. So his state as he walked down the sidewalk was a combination of sadness, of regret, and of wondering what life was really all about if it wasn't all about the principles of Love Songylvania, which was to sing love songs to each other. So as he walked down the business district, he happened to pass one of the music shops, of which there were many in town. And as he passed it, he looked to his right at the window, and he saw a sign there, a listing. And he knew what it was, because when he was with the girl, he'd stop very often and look at the window at the latest love songs of Love Songylvania and go over and read them and buy half of them. So by habit, he went over to the list and looked at it. And sure enough, there was a list of all the 24 hit songs of the week in Love Songylvania. And I'm going to read to you the titles of some of the love songs that he read as he stood there. Here we go. The titles of the love songs of the week in Love Songylvania. You promised me a cottage by a pretty waterfall, and now you won't even fix the shower. Hello, I'm Sally's best friend, and I'm going to help you to stop wondering about what's become of Sally. Love song 3. I don't mind you leaving me for 30 years, but where's the loaf of bread I sent you for? I couldn't do the cooking tonight, so I'm sorry I made you fry. My darling sweetheart, I will serenade you tonight beneath your balcony, but what is that bucket for? My darling Tommy, I treasure the dozens of love letters you send me, but please note that my name is Helen, not Grace. I will give you my most romantic kiss out in the garden, unless you would find it more pleasant to pull weeds. Remember, these were all hit songs of the week in Love Songylvania. The next one. Mildred, I don't mind you scolding me, but just remember that you are criticizing the man I love. Wilbur, I know I often talk like an idiot when I'm with you, but remember that I am trying to establish communication. I will meet you in the moonlight tonight, my dearest, and don't forget the crackers and smoked herring. So our hero, after reading all the love songs, continued his walk down the street. And it was about noon, and he came to a open-air cafe, and he sat down at one of the tables there. Waiter came over and took his order. And while he was seated there, his eyes were just wandering around, doing nothing particular. But all of a sudden, he stopped, startled and a little embarrassed, but also a little delighted, because at a table across several feet away was his girlfriend that he had broken up with several months ago. And he knew that he looked at her, that she also looked at him, and her eyes went down in shyness, and his is in uncertainty. So I don't know if you've if any of you have ever been in a situation like that before. Huh? So they looked at each other, and finally he knew that he was the man who should take the aggression, so he looked at her once more and he said, I'm going to do it. I'm going to walk over there and talk to her. So he walked over, and as he did, he watched her face because he knew that she could see him coming, and she looked up and she smiled. And so he sat down there, and silent for a little bit. And after a while he said, we're not very mature, are we? And she said, you're right. We go around hurting each other all the time. This is the way human beings do. And so they relaxed a little bit and talked easily, and they both agreed that they were immature themselves. And one of the principal contributors to their immaturity and to their lack of real concern for each other was the love songs of Love Songylvania. They believed in mere words. And so they had a nice, pleasant conversation together and were more delighted to be together than they wanted to show on the surface, because you know how it is, how people want to play it safe. You tell me that you like me first and all that. But inwardly, they liked each other and communicated that to each other. Finally, the man looked at his watch and he said, I'm awful sorry, but I have an appointment that I have to keep. But would you like to walk down the street with me toward my appointment? And she very eagerly said, yes, I would. So they left the cafe and walked on down the street, and walked for a block or two. They finally ended up a little bit away from the business district, two or three blocks away. And they came to a new building there, and both of them at once noticed that there was another list in the window. And they thought at first that it might have been the love song list, but after looking a little closer, they saw it wasn't. So they said, what's that? Let's go over and look at it. So they went over, and there was another list on the window. And the other list had added at its top, it said, how to cure yourself of the love songs of Love Songylvania. And they both stood there, and they read that list, which I will now read to you. Here's what they read. Realize that using the word love does not make you loving any more than calling yourself a lump of sugar makes you one. Talking is 1,000 times easier than pondering, which is why the talkers overwhelm the earth. Free yourself of the tyranny of believing in mere words. There's nothing wrong with nothing happening in your life. See this and something worthwhile will happen. You are definitely worried about something when it returns repeatedly to your mind. You are not worried about something when you suddenly remember that you have not been thinking about it. Knowing that you are lost is exactly the same thing as sensing the way back home. Spiritual facts always sound harmonious. You just have untuned ears. Only a clear understanding of time thinking can free you from its folly. For example, an ambitious man can think about acquiring earthly power, but he cannot think about finally losing it. Count the number of enemies you have outside, and that is the same number of enemies you have inside. In a true man, spirit is the king and thought is the obedient servant. In a false man, thought is the king and the spirit is considered an enemy. The higher power does not need your aid. End your vanity. The higher power seeks to tell you to stop trying to help both it and yourself, for this enables it to help you. Thinking produces noisy and wrong action. Seeing allows silent and right action. Did it ever occur to you that your inner kingdom is a sacred place? Now, what is the right attitude to have toward a sacred place? When faced, a harmful fact can be changed, but you can do nothing with a suppressed delusion but suffer from it. Interpretation blocks reception while masquerading as reception. Rightness does not need interpretation. It requires simple acceptance and nothing else. As incredible as it sounds, an unhappy man does not realize that happiness is better than unhappiness. Knowing only his own concealed anguish, he worships it, which is the same as self-worship. And the last one, and listen especially to this, please. Resurrection is a definite spiritual experience. It is something that happens to you. It happens when you no longer try to make things happen. So the boy and the girl finished reading the list of the cures for the love songs of Love Songylvania. And when they did, they took a little closer look at the shop itself. And there was the glass window with certain displays in it. And they looked inside and they saw a sign. And the sign said, New Life Foundation. And in the window, very nicely displayed, were dozens of very attractive looking books and cassette tapes. And one of the books was entitled Esoteric Mind Power. And the man again looked at his watch and he said, I'm awfully sorry, but I do have to leave to keep this appointment. But he said, tomorrow's Saturday, and he hesitated a little bit. He said, tomorrow's Saturday. I wonder if you could meet me here tomorrow at noon, and we'll go inside this shop and investigate what they have to offer. It looks very interesting. And she said, oh, yes, I've heard about this New Life Foundation and the books they put out, and I'd like very much to investigate it. So it was settled in their mind. They both knew that part of it was their own personal relationship. They sensed that. But they were also very definite in wanting to go inside the shop and see what they had to offer that would change their inner nature. So they turned away from the shop, and this was the parting moment, and they both a little bit embarrassed about it and shy. But they were also greatly relieved because they knew they would see each other the next day. It was settled. And so they looked into each other's eyes, and they both understood. They both understood that all was well and that all was going to be well because they were going to do something higher than themselves, work with something that was higher than their own minds. So their human relationship after that became right because they put the kingdom of heaven first. The lack of demand for control is control. Now you think about that as we proceed tonight, because we're going to go into a very mysterious subject, that of the control of one's life. Can you see how much of your day, of your life, is spent, along with the rest of the world, in simply trying to control things? In trying to influence people to get what you want from them, trying to control your temper, trying to put out your personal kind of propaganda in order to influence someone to your way of thinking, to get their vote or get their money or get their applause or get their friendship or get their sex or whatever. Maybe you have never thought very deeply about how involved the whole world is in trying to control other people and events, trying to force them to conform to what we believe will be a favorable result for us. And if you haven't thought about it, then you go away from here tonight giving a lot of thought to it, and you'll see that you have rarely touched the very surface of the topic of control. People don't control themselves, their own lives, and yet they want to control the world. As a matter of fact, there is a law involved in that. The least control, the less control an individual has over his own internal state, the more he will be compelled, forced, whipped along to try to control other people. Because this means that in his state of weakness, of immaturity, he's going to try to get rid of the pain of the fact by trying to prove that he does have power. And what he does is hurt. What he does is destroy. All unconscious, not seeing that his own lack of internal command of himself, of his life, spiritual command, not seeing that his own lack of that is what spurs him on, and this is the cause of all the destruction in the world. Incompetent people, weak people, people who refuse to see their inner conditions, going out and trying to change the world, and instead of just wrecking it. That should be a very familiar scene to you as you look out into this world. Now, right now, at the start of this evening, it would be a marvelous idea if you simply abandoned all ideas that you have about yourself regarding control. Because any ideas you may have that you can control this or that are utterly false. You control nothing at all. What you do is try to control, and under certain accidental factors, results conform to what you want, and you give yourself credit for having done it. It just happened automatically, accidentally. And in our vanity, we think that there is someone there who caused it to happen. Man of himself does not cause things to happen. The human mind doesn't work that way. But we attribute all these things to ourselves, all these results, favorable ones we attribute to our intelligence and our bravery, and unfavorable ones we attribute to the enmity of other people out there, right? So that our egotism can never lose. It always wins, because it can always distort things and make itself a winner. So as we proceed, kindly drop all notions, all unconscious ideas you may have about yourself controlling anything, because you don't. And you will see by the end of this evening that the beauty of it is that you don't have to command anything. You don't have to painfully try to twist results. You don't have to go out into the world and try to win this or push away that. All the sorrow and the pain and the frustration and anxiety involved in trying to win will be gone. You will see. You'll see something entirely different in your life. But the first stage, and the most important one for now, suspend any ideas you may have about the fact that you are a controller, that you command things. You don't command anything. Because in reality, and we'll get to this later, in reality, there is no controller at all. You understand? If you set yourself up as someone who commands someone else, there is you the commander, and that which is commanded, and already there's a division, and already you're worried whether you're going to actually command that event out there or not. And you're worried that you're going to be found out by yourself or by other people if you fail in your attempt to influence. So we live in a state of constant dread of self-exposure and other exposure, as long as we believe that we can command, do something out there in the world. And I want to illustrate it as follows. Imagine a country where everybody travels around through the air in balloons. You know, you've seen them, big balloons with a basket suspended underneath. And in this particular place we're talking about, every individual has his own balloon and his own basket. One person only in the basket, no more than one. We're in this world alone, in one sense. So here's a man who's brought into this world where everyone travels around in baskets, in balloons overhead, and going up into the sky and immediately becoming under the influence of the winds, the storms, the weather. So a hero of our illustration gets in his basket and he goes up and he wonders how he's going to control the balloon. And he doesn't see any control buttons, handles anywhere. So he goes up, and one wind whips him that way, and an hour later another wind that way, up, down, side. And he feels helpless. He can't get to where he wants to go. He has a certain destination in mind, 50 miles away, and he can't reach there. How is he going to do it? He has no command over the balloon at all. And that worries him. He gets anxious over it. So the next time he gets down to Earth, he does what everyone else does, who's doing the same thing with their balloon, going up and seeing they have no control. They look around, they say, how can I learn to control the balloon in order to get what I want? I saw a pleasurable place I'd like to go to. I saw a place where I could make a lot of money over there, and a lot of other places I'd like to go, but there's no way I can make the balloon go where I want to go, it to go in order to get what I want. So all the people on Earth, and you'll follow this as a illustrative story, I'm sure, all the people on Earth look around for someone to tell them how to control the balloon. And wherever there's someone who asks the question, there's someone who will say, I have the answer. And so this man goes to a school. And it's very expensive, of course. And you have to go a long time, because the longer you go, the more money they get. And so he enrolls in the school, which supposedly tells him how to control the balloon and therefore get what he wants. And it's a very complicated system, and he barely understands half of it, and he barely manages to pass the tests and graduate from the school. But as best he can understand, it goes something like this. There are the winds up there, and you can control the balloon and their relationship to the wind by certain leaning exercises. If you understand the wind is coming from one direction, you lean in the basket in one direction, and you supposedly go in the direction you want to go. And he didn't understand it, really didn't, because it's too complex, and there really was nothing to understand anyway, but that's how they made their living, the educators. So he tried it, and nothing happened. He was just as wild as he was before, just as distraught and just as worried that he wasn't going to get anywhere in life. So he came down and did what other people do. He went to another school. And the next school told him, the first one was all wrong. We have the real secret for you controlling the balloon and getting what you want out of life. And what you have to do is make a series of mental declarations while you're up there. And what you have to do is say to yourself with all the willpower you can bring up, I am in control, I am in control, repeat it over and over. And he said that 10 times in one day, and he crashed 10 times in one day. And as he had all these horrid little experiences, getting angrier and more frustrated all the time, and worried that he wasn't going to make it, he also looked around and saw that the other balloonists were having the same problem. They crashed too. And he had one very interesting experience with one man. One man who had crashed repeatedly over several months. The hero of our story went over and said to the man, I noticed that you're out of control, that you crash a lot. And the man looked at him and said, no, I'm not out of control. And our hero said, you must be out of control because you crash a lot. The man said, no, I'm not out of control, but you crash a lot. I'm not out of control. He finally understood something that later helped him. That right in the face of a fact, a human being can deny it because he's afraid to admit it. So he learned a few things in that experience. He also learned something else. He learned that human beings are very shallow in their thinking, very superstitious. And he found this out by looking at both his own balloon and the thousands of others up there who were equally cruising around aimlessly and crashing. He saw that everyone who owned their balloon tried to make it very attractive on the outside. Painted it bright colors and pretty designs on it and all that. And he supposed they did that in order to exert some kind of an influence on the weather, on the winds. But he didn't understand that either, but this is the way it was. Now, leave the balloonist up there dangling for a minute. Have you followed up to this point what we are doing in our life, trying to control what? Trying to control the inner condition? Trying to control that horrible temper, that uncertainty, that nervousness? And we all have these little schemes and these little plans whereby if we do certain things, if we say certain things, something is going to change. Never does it? We come right back to where we were before, and we go to schools, and we spend a lot of money, and we end up just as lost as we were before. Back to the balloonist now. Put him up in the air again. Here he is, 20 years, trying to control the balloon, trying to find out if there is a way in which he, as a human being, can exert control over where he's going in order to get what he wants. And every once in a while, just by sheer circumstances, he lands exactly where he wants to land, at that pleasurable spot where he can make a lot of money. And he gets real hopeful and he says, I've got the secret at last. And the next several days it goes the opposite and he crashes again and he's right back where he started. Our story, the story of human life on earth. Well, listen to what happened to him next. One day he was way up high and a fierce storm came up, gales of wind. And a great fear came over him because he had never experienced such a terrific storm before with all the lightning and the thunder crashing around him. And he felt very alone and very helpless up there. And he still didn't know how to control the balloon, so there he was. What was he going to do? How is he going to get to a safe place? And the storm got worse and he could feel the pressure of it pushing him down and down and down. And he finally crashed on a mountainside. And he lay there stunned for quite a while. It wasn't badly injured, but badly stunned. And as he was laying there on the ground alongside his basket, after all these years, a new thought came to him. And listen to what this thought was. Something he didn't want to face. The thought was, as a fact, as a reality, I am not in control of that balloon of our lives. I'm not in control of that balloon, and I know that nothing I do will ever make it so. He knew, listen to this now, this is important, because he'd come to a climax. I see absolutely that there's nothing I can do to control the balloon, our life, his life. Nothing I can do. Well, what does he say next after that? What does he do next? He didn't know. He'd gone to enough schools, and he knew that nothing happened there. He'd tried his own little experiments in trying to get what he wanted by making the balloon go over there or over there. Nothing happened. Seeing that he was actually at the end of his thoughts, he did nothing. He didn't try to revive his hopes at all. So he got up, still in a daze, and walked away from the wrecked basket. Walking down a trail, apparently some people had been there before. And when he got ahead a little bit, he saw something astonishing. And what he saw in a clearing was a little schoolhouse, just ordinary little schoolhouse, which surprised him because he knew there wasn't any city or children or civilization around at all. So he walked up, schoolhouse, door was open. And inside he saw the name of the school. And it said, School for Balloonists Who Have Crashed Out of Control. Ah, just what I was looking for, School for Balloonists Who Have Crashed Out of Control. Went a little farther and he looked at the blackboard. And it said, today's lesson on the blackboard. And today's lesson was, and he read this carefully in very large print, it said, you are not a part from the sky. You are not a part in the sky. You are both the balloon and the wind. Are you following this? Try. You are both the balloon and the wind. What do I make of that? I'm not apart from the sky. I am both the balloon and the wind. What does that mean? He spent the rest of his life finding out what it meant. And when he saw the answer, it was a completely different life. It's the kind of life we're seeking right in this room, wherein he saw that there is really no controller. And there isn't. You are not a controller. I am not. And when you see that, the controller disappears. Therefore, the need to control anything, to grasp anything, to influence anyone. Do you see this or not? This is a long leap from what you've been told before and what you've been telling yourself all this time. Look how simple it is. If you were both the balloon and the wind, if you were both, which you are, because you're in your real nature, you're unified. If you are both of these, then there's no balloonist to make any demands on the wind to take you anywhere. Now what happens? If you are both, then there's no opposition between the balloonist, the balloon, and the winds and the sky. There's no opposition. There's no enemy out there to control, to influence. There's only one thing. Now, if there's just one thing, is there a problem? No problem at all. See, it's our neurotic demands that says, I must go over here. I must influence that. I must get this or that from that person or from society. If you disappear as the demander, what are you going to demand? Nothing. Then how can there be conflict? How can there be any need at all to look at any other person and hope that they're going to conform to what you want? Do you understand this a little bit? You try as hard as you can, and it'll come to you after a while. Or you see, I'll repeat it in a little different way this time, where there's no demand, there can't be any frustration of the demand. And there can't be any false elation over the fact that is accidental that you got what you demanded. Do you know what this is called? This state is called peace of mind. Or does the world consider peace of mind an enemy because it's taking away all the fight and all the what the world calls adventure and going out and winning what you want and doing exciting things? You see, we've talked about eternity many times. A person living in eternity right here while he's here in this life, he understands this fact. And there, listen to this. In that state, is there any yearning for eternity? Is there anyone to say, give me this or give me that? You are it. How many people do you suppose in this world are going to listen to a talk like this and say, that's what I've been looking for? Isn't it going to be a shock, a jolt to their entire system? And aren't they going to distort these facts because they're afraid to give up? Afraid to give up the demander. Will you be different? Will you try something a little different? Will you go ahead and see that you're in the state that we talked about, where you want something desperately, and you think that you have to control that person in order to get what you want. You have to control that situation. You want more money in your business or whatever, and you have to put pressure on someone. Suppose you didn't. Suppose you never, ever again put pressure on another human being over anything. Wouldn't that automatically make you a different kind of a person? And isn't that what you're after? Doesn't the sameness continue from day to day? Answer yes. Because it does. Why does the sameness continue? First, because perhaps at this point in your life you haven't collected the knowledge that is necessary. And after that comes the action stage that we talk about so much, where you're up in that balloon and you're wandering around and your eyes spot something that you want. You see that industrial section that you want to own. You see that woman or that man that you want to go toward. And already, because you want it, because you think you have to have it, you begin to figure out ways to control the balloon so that it will go over there. And you have created a false self and a demand in there that if you continue with it, it's going to keep you floating and agonizing for the rest of your life. Now, there's a way to break it. Oh, the way to break it is to start breaking it. The way to break it is to take some very small little demand, some little desire, watch it trying to take you over so that you feel a certain power in making the demand, and then you look and see how you're afraid of crashing, which you will do every time. This business of thinking that you must control is dreadful, terrible punishment from day to day. Human beings who do not understand these facts that we're talking about are living in daily self-laceration, daily self-punishment. In this class, we're trying to understand what is happening to us as a result of not understanding spiritual principles, and then acting out a life not based on these principles and paying the price for it. As you begin to study more, and as you get brave enough to do what you don't usually do, you will look out at that world and all these colored balloons, all the famous people in the world, all the people who have achieved great things, and no longer will you ever have an urge, a yearning to say, I want to control life so that I get what they have. You know why? Your life is quite different, and I'll tell you what it's like. You're up in the balloon, and the wind blows you west. You are not apart from the wind that's blowing you west. You are one with it. You go west, and that's the end of it. You're perfectly content. You're not creating a false demand to go east or north or south. Life becomes so easy with this. Next day, the wind blows you north. You go north because north is what you are. Understand? North is what you are too. You're all directions. You're everything. What I'm saying is there's no protests. There's no protests in you at all. No antagonism toward what is happening to you, because you know that your real nature is always going in the right direction. And it has to go in the right direction because the nature itself is right. You've watched yourself suffer so much. You've seen yourself go in one direction. The wind takes you north, and you've seen yourself cry, but I want to go south. My security, my happiness, my future depends on me going south, but I don't know how to go south. Someone won't let me go south. And you saw your tears. How long are you going to endure the punishment of your own lack of understanding of the laws of life? Stop right where you are, right now. Start right now and try to see the direction you're going, and try to see that the direction that you're now going into is wrong because you are wrong. Because you are wrong. Then when I am right, your nature is right. Listen to this. What a beautiful thought. When your nature is right, every direction is right. Because you didn't want anything opposite to it, contrary to it. You're content with being yourself. You're quite happy in being what you are. And what you are is a human being who has an authentically new mind. You have a new spirit. You think different toward everything, toward all events. There's no opposition, no fight. You're content. You're content with being a real man, a real woman. You're quite content with what God, truth, reality gives you. Now, isn't that a nice place to be? Did you understand the talk?
No.
You understand then that it's unnecessary demands that creates the division, that makes it seemingly necessary to control the balloon? It's not necessary to control the balloon. It is if you're divided, because then there's the balloon and the winds, right? The balloon is you, and you have to control those winds because they seem to be taking the balloon somewhere. What if the division collapsed? See? What if there was no you in opposition to anything out there, such as the winds of life? What if there was no you there to want anything, to fear them, to project any wrong movement toward them? Would there be fear? The controller's going to have to disappear, isn't he? Ah, let's make it clearer than that. The illusion of the controller has to disappear. Do you know anybody who will give up that illusion? Are you living with a person who will give it up? You understand that it's the very same thing as giving up your life in order to have life?
Yes.
It's exactly the same thing. You know that. I saw a hand somewhere. Gordon.
But it looks like the way I'm going, if I gave up, I wouldn't get to my next crash.
That's important to have crashes, yes, if that's what you're saying. Very necessary. Crash is part of the fun.
As long as I have fear and anger, I will never leave people alone.
Yeah, how's that for a thought? Always nagging people? Didn't we have a sentence one time that said something like, if you want to be a nice person, it's very simple, just leave people alone. Quit bothering people with your nutty little life. Larry liked that one. Go ahead, Harvey, then, Pat.
My vanity will not allow me to leave people alone and has created a tremendous amount of suffering.
We're so sick, we say, nothing in this life is important except for me to go around blabbing, complaining. Never mind the other person. This is the pressure I have, and I've got to release it in some way, no matter who I hurt. What a philosophy. What a fatal philosophy. Pat.
Last day, or your airplane went out of sight about the point where you gave today's lesson, that you are not apart from the sky. But even though I couldn't understand exactly what you were talking about, I knew that what you were saying was right.
You sensed it, didn't you? All right. You can connect it with what we've talked about before. How does the mind operate? In opposites, correct? The opposite, the balloonist and the winds, right? The balloonist, same thing. And the winds. There's the balloonist. He looks out into the world, as we all do, and his greedy little eyes spots all these things he wants to have. I must have that woman. I must get rid of that problem, whatever. All the things you want to have, get rid of things, whatever. You see all these things, and then, but how? How am I going to do it? See, it's an insane person, an insane mind that says, how am I going to get that? It has to be an insane mind, because it's asking, how can I fulfill an illusion to make it look real by getting what I want, what I demand? There's your division. This false entity here, up in the balloon. And then when the wind doesn't give it what it wants, it hates the wind. Which by the way, is the same thing as hating nature. Now, Phyllis.
Then the winds can be likened to events that occur in life. And if you just go along with the wind, go along with the wind, in conflict, you become one with them. And just go along with it.
Yes, that's one way to put it. And another way is, how nice it is to let the rest of the world go by. You, wherever you are on your spiritual path, you're already practicing that, aren't you? Are you involved in the madness of this social world? Aren't you seeing yourself withdraw from it and let the world do what it wants? You're not going to control it anyway. If you think you can control it, you're still up in that balloon crashing and going crazy. Let the world go crazy all by itself. Count yourself out. But you have to have insight to do this. Crazy people have such a crazy need for going crazy. It's a compulsive thing. Who did I see?
People who are not letting the rest of the world go by resent the person who is letting the rest of the world go by.
Yes, and if they notice you at all, they'll put labels on you that you're apathetic, you're not doing your part for social improvement. Of course, they are, by driving everyone nuts that they go around. How many of you drive other people nuts? Let's see your hands. Yeah, that's right.
The superstition in me says that when accidentally my demands are fulfilled, it was done just for me.
It was what?
It was done just for me.
Yes, done, and by you too. Yes. Your mighty mind caused that event to happen. Your sheer brilliant intelligence. Does that describe you, B?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
You mentioned something about people painting the balloons. Now, would you be referring here to religions and the way people pray in order to get the things that they want and the outer trappings?
Any way you want to describe it. I talk generally, of course, in a short talk about the designs on the balloons, painting them to make them look attractive and all that. I was talking generally about our exterior appearances, how we do make things gaudy and bubbly in order to attract people, just to attract people. And it does, it works. But that's also a part of the wanting to control, therefore it is fatal.
I would say that I spend about a third of my time and energy in frustration over not being in control. Could you comment on that?
Yes, up it to about 90%. You know, I started the talk with asking you to see how much of your time was involved trying to persuade people. I know you don't see it. I know you don't. How about trying to persuade people right here in this room that you're nicer than you actually are at home? How many of you here are worser at home than you are here? See? Those hard looks on your face towards someone else out there that you'd never show here would give you away, huh? You're supposed to be a spiritual student.
The word manipulation really connects with all this. That's constant.
See, we're up in the balloon and we see something we want. Desperately, let's say this is a strong one, and we really, in our delusion and confusion, we really believe that if we don't get that, that something dreadful will happen to us in the form of diminution. That is, we will grow lesser and lesser if we don't add that object or person to us. So we really believe that our continuance as a separate self depends on attaining it. And this is where lack of conscience and a lack of decency comes in. A man who is desperate over his life, he'll do anything and he'll justify it. He'll say, I've got to have that object. that event. I've got to twist things. My very survival depends on it. See how when he starts from a false premise, all his actions are going to be equally false and dangerous and harmful and foolish. Well, that's why we have to start from the very beginning and try to see why we want that person, why we want that event to conform. It's because we think that if it doesn't, something will happen to us that will be against life. And we don't understand that we're against life ourselves by trying to attain it. We don't see our delusion, our contradiction, our utterly, utterly shallow thinking. And the way we're going to see it is to go through the pain. Go through the pain of saying, all right, I see that object out there, and I see what an attraction, and I see how desperate I am to get it. All right, but I've heard something different. I've heard that if I just quietly watch my desire, if I watch it, something different will happen to it, and it will. You'll begin to understand it because you're not throwing the full force of all your neurosis into it. The other day at a business meeting, I brought out the point that if you will bear the pain, you will pain the bear. Remember that? If you will bear the pain, that is, bear it, not run away from it, you will pain the bear. Bear the pain, you will pain the bear. You will see the bear himself start to object to you doing that. The devil, the dark forces, doesn't want you to do anything that goes against it, and you will hear it growl. You will hear the bear growl and say, don't you cross me like that. I've had you all these years, and I'm not going to let you go that easy. As a serious and very wise student, you will bear the pain and pain the bear deliberately so that you can hear him growling. Now, are you safe in the company of a growling bear? No, you're in danger. And you can begin to see this now by hearing the growl, by going against what the bear wants. When you really know you've been living with a grouchy bear, really know it, doesn't that give you an urge to move out? How many of you live with a grouchy bear named you? See? When you see through, for example, you see through your former tendency to use these teachings for personal benefit, when you see through that, it gives you a certain sense of loss, doesn't it? Because you were counting, are you following?
Yeah.
Because you were counting on these teachings perhaps to give you what other sources didn't. In other words, you're using the teachings for wrong purpose. What I'm saying is that's a great and necessary stage to come to see where we're beginning to use it like we use everything else. And then you have to drop that. Well, one more hope shattered. Isn't that great? What do you think it's all about but shattering all hopes? All hopes to try to control something out there. And if you can't do anything else, you notice how fear is caused by you wanting to influence another person your way. The very attempt to influence, to persuade, to command, to twist them is fear, because you are not living with your whole nature. You're living with that one little part that desperately screams out, I've got to have this. Aren't we beginning to see a little bit? We don't have to have it at all. It's a lie from our old nature that wants to keep us in prison. We've been in prison long enough. Out we go as fast as we can. Go cover it just a little bit, the idea of attention, and in a new way of looking at it right now, keeping your attention where it should be. Now, where should your attention be? Your attention should be, if you can follow this, your attention should be everywhere. Do you know that right now my attention is everywhere? My attention is both this way and it's that way. It's both inward and it's outward. When your attention is just in one direction, you're seeing something, but you're not understanding it. When you have your attention in just one direction, you're seeing something, but you're interpreting it according to yourself. That means that you are seeing something. That old distorting, everlastingly petty and angry, etc., self is seeing something and twisting it in order to keep itself alive. For example, suppose I look out and I see someone there back of the room. I see someone and memory is operating, and I remember some little incident, quarrel, let's say, disagreement that happened a year ago. Okay, and I look and I see this person, and unless I'm very awake, instead of having whole attention, I will simply have one direction attention, and memory will operate, and I'll see that person's face, and I'll begin to think of the little quarrel, and of course how wrong he was. I was right, you know. That means I have not stayed in full attention. Now, if I'm talking to you now, and I see that person back there, and I'm watching this as well as that, I see the memory of the incident. Okay, so far it's pure. I see it happen. But I'm so alert this way too that I begin to see the old dark force wanting to put me into that memory and say, of course I was right. Am I not always right? But I catch it starting to talk to me, see? And this attention, watching it, cancels it before it gets up here and takes me over. Have you had that experience?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. I had a picture come in my mind when you were talking about the balloons, and that is of people, the one thing they carry in their basket is a grappling hook to catch other baskets so they can be together and crash.
Andy, how many of you are balloonists? Let's see the balloonists. All right. That balloonist up there with his pretty gaudy colors on there, calculated to attract good fortune from the winds. That balloonist, is you've started this off, sees all the hundreds of other balloons around, and he gets anxious and worried and jealous, and he sees something great, and he sees all these hundred other balloonists, the leaning technique, trying to get it go over. It doesn't work, but he's jealous. And, you know, the wind happened to catch that other man's balloon just right, and he goes down and he gets rich. Now you're mad. Well, I'm persecuted. The wind caught him, he got rich, and I've got nothing. See? How many are tired of being batty in the brain? Well, stick. Your ordinary work will come under your command in the right way much better as you go into these things. Sitting there doing, how many of you go crazy? You're sitting down there doing something, calls on your attention, and you can't keep your attention in that direction for now. All the bats are fluttering around out there. An interesting part of our work is watching the change of pace in the physical body. You're walking at one time, you're seated at another, you're resting or halfway asleep or whatever. Whatever your physical body is doing, your inner work is always the same. It's always this sentry watching. And you can know, for example, that you're walking very fast, and now I'm walking real slow, and then I turned over to the right to see something there. You can do this, and you must do it as an exercise. Just watch the physical self move around. Watch what it's doing every minute. Know what's happening all the time. This is part of your work. Then you can catch your moods later on, which is more difficult because the ego is more involved. One thing that you'll see, and I know you've seen it because so many of you have commented, one thing you know absolutely, that your boss is exactly a sleeping human being. Now you know it, aren't you? Don't you understand what it means to be a sleeping human? You know it. There he is. There's that machine. You can even see he's a machine walking across the room. He doesn't know he's walking across the room. He's got some little trouble on his mind like that. Well, just let me repeat it. We get what we actually are. To get something different, we must change what we are. And there's where the work comes in. There's no way to put it any simpler than that. And there's no need to, because an earnest, honest person will look at that, and he will sense the rightness of it. Then he can go to work.
Sometimes when you speak, in a forceful way. My false self uses that to think, perhaps someday I'll have control over myself like that. And in that way, I use you as an example for a building up of the idea that perhaps I can have control at one time.
All right. I know you are aware that you must use words consciously. And having said that, I will add this. Try as a practice, instead of saying, I will have control, saying, there will be control. Even pull your I out of the sentence, because there's what it's all about. I can't have control. Vernon can't have control. Larry can't. Sally can't have control. There can be control when we disappear as the controller. There is control. And look how difficult this is for the mind to grasp, though. See, because the mind always thinks in I, always thinks in self. And there is a way to see without thinking that. Now you have to go on until you understand that. Did the airplane go out of sight?
Yes.
Right. One lesson, well learned, can lift 1,000 problems, 1,000 burdens. And I want to tell you one of those lessons here this morning in the form of a story, which will lead up to the point. There was once a man who was very much interested in potato farming as an amateur, not as a professional. So he looked out at his backyard, and there was lots of room to grow potatoes out in his backyard. So he said, I'm going to have a garden this year, nothing but potatoes. That's what I'm going to concentrate on. So he went down to the bookstore and bought a book entitled How to Grow Potatoes in Your Own Backyard. And he took it home and he studied it and looked at the illustrations and absorbed the knowledge pretty well for the first couple hundred pages of the book anyway. And after getting all this knowledge, he went out in his backyard and he followed all the instructions in it. He prepared the soil, he watered it, he put up little fences around the place where the potatoes would develop. And he planted the potato buds properly spaced, as the book said. And he had a lot of fun doing it. It was quite enjoyable. So after a while, the garden was all planted. There was his little tiny potatoes, potential potatoes down in the ground. And like most gardeners, he eagerly looked forward to the first day when the first little green leaves would poke above the ground. You know how it does, just pokes the earth aside a little bit the first day. He just looked forward to that so much, and the day came. He went out, and the first morning there was just 3 little leaves coming above ground, little green leaves. Next morning there was 5 or 6 more, and after a week there's the whole plot was covered with little green buds starting to come up. And he was pleased at his work. But at a certain point in looking at his garden, his pleasure vanished, and he began to worry. And he began to worry that maybe something would go wrong. And he thought, well, now as a good gardener, I better just start thinking about the possibility of things not developing rightly on those potatoes, and I better do something about it to ensure the success of my potato farming. So to add to his worry was the fact that he wandered around out and back where the neighbors also had potato patches. And he saw to his astonishment and sorrow that their potato plants was 3 times as high as his were. And he reasoned that they had planted them at the same time he had, and he felt a little bit inferior because his plants were only 1 inch tall and theirs were 3 inches tall. So he said, well, humility is a virtue, he said to himself. So I'm going to be humble enough to ask my neighbors how they did it. And also, maybe I'm doing something wrong and I'm going to find out so that I don't lose the potatoes. So he went over to his neighbors and he said, I've noticed that your potato plants are much higher than mine, seem healthier and more prosperous and thriving. Could you give me some advice on how I can improve my potato garden? Oh, they were so eager. The first man he asked said, well, of course I can tell you exactly how to do it. You know where I'm leading, don't you? Are you ahead of me already? Let's see. So the first neighbor came over and said, I know exactly what you should do because look how prosperous I am. What you should do is mix a little sawdust with the soil. That's what I do. I mix sawdust with the ground, and that makes my potatoes what they are. And the man came over and took sawdust and threw it all over the man's garden. He didn't ask him to do that, and he felt a little bit resentful that man came over and also trampled a few of the young plants. Man threw sawdust over it and disappeared. Another neighbor came over at his request. The neighbor came over and he said, oh, what I do is use colored water. I put a little coloring in my water, sprinkle it all over the potato garden. That makes potatoes come up very nicely. So without asking the man whether he actually wanted an example or not, the man put colored water all over his garden, and he also trampled a few plants. And this went on and on. The neighbor's giving all sort of strange advice, but the potato plants seemed to stay as they were. They didn't seem to grow any better. And his worry increased. So he said, well, if my neighbors can't do it, I can. So he began inventing his own little devices on how to make a guarantee that the potatoes would grow right. So he did all sorts of strange things that he didn't read in the book. He would, for example, talk to the plants. And he told the plants he loved them. He heard that somewhere in some other kind of book. And you can imagine that, he'd go around kneeling down before the plant saying, I love you, potato patch plant. He still continued to worry that something was going wrong. And he even trampled on his own little potato plants, tender little plants, as he wandered around trying to make them grow. This went on for a long, long time. And the main thing was that he had lost his pleasure in growing the potatoes. So he wondered what to do next. And he finally said to himself, I wonder if I haven't been, if I've missed something in the book. That's what he said. After all, I didn't read the last pages of it. So I'll go back and see if I've left anything out that the book instructed me to do. So he picked up the book and he went to the very last page. And sure enough, there was something there that he'd never noticed before. And he looked at it and did a double take, looked at it again, and there was a notice in the very last page, and it said, to grow successful potatoes or to grow anything else successfully in life, you must fall in love with Meg. He shook his head. Let me see if I read that right. And he did read it right. It said, in order to be successful in potato farming or in anything else, you must fall in love with Meg. I don't know any girl named Meg, he said to himself. I wouldn't mind, but I don't know any girl named Meg. So he went around for the next several days trying to figure out this very strange message. Maybe Meg was a potato expert lady or something. Maybe she could tell him how to grow better potatoes. And he went around asking different girls, is your name Meg? One girl said, no, my name is Priscilla, but I'm nicer than Meg. The mystery deepened. Great frustration increased to greater frustration. Finally, he heard of a wise man. And this wise man gave advice by mail. So he wrote off to the wise man and said, who's Meg? 2 or 3 days later, wise man wrote back to him, and on the outside of the letter, there's a little notation that said, Meg enclosed. And he thought, Meg must be a pretty slender girl, huh? He opened up the letter, and inside was Meg, and he fell in love with her. Shall I build it up a little more? Meg. Meddling ends growth. M-E-G. Meddling ends growth. And he looked at that and he said, of course. How could I have been so stupid as to not see it? He fell in love all over with Meg, and he stayed in love with her for the rest of his life. May I ask you, when are you going to stop interfering with nature, with what is right for you? When are you going to leave your life alone? When are you going to leave your wife alone? Did it ever occur to you that your life is now spent in doing foolish, needless, interfering things so that truth can't work for you? Now, that's a very simple illustration. I hope you see plenty of points in it for your life. Let's see. Let's go right down the list and see how many we can add. Useless thinking? Why do you interfere with growth, with understanding, with useless thinking, with foolish reactions when someone comes up to you? Someone comes up to you and you don't know how to react, so you invent one. Why don't you try not knowing what to do? That is, stop interfering with your natural intelligence that could tell you what to do. It is there already, but you interfere. You've got your own little odd and end things that you throw into it, trampling on the little plants. Don't you understand that the whole world is dedicated to interference? Now, get back to yourself. You're not going to see the world until you see the world inside yourself. It is necessary to start and end with yourself on this business of leaving yourself alone. Look at the madness that we employ, thinking that we're going to further the growth of the potatoes or the life or whatever. We're thinking that we're going to further it by doing something. There's nothing you can do intelligent because you don't have intelligence. Now, if that's a blow to your vanity, then let it be the worst blow of your life and endure it. There's no way you can think yourself higher. There's no way you can take any ideas and plan and contrive to do it. What kind of a life would you have if you just went around simply letting everything alone? Impossible! You've got too much neurosis in you that screams to go out and cause trouble to yourself and everyone you meet. You don't know what I'm talking about. You don't know how profound this is. You don't know how the world is indeed dedicated to causing trouble to other people. A person in trouble with himself can only express outwardly what he is inwardly. All these anxieties and tensions, which you won't do the right thing with them, and so you do the wrong thing. And instead of the garden coming up right, that is your life coming up right, it comes up wrong. All right, what has been the results of you employing false methods? You know what the results have been, that you never change. Your imagination is living your life for you. And I'll repeat that, because I know a lot of you are doing this right in this room. You're not leading your own life, the natural life where truth is causing growth, natural growth. Imagination is living your life, and you're quite satisfied with that. And no one can tell you different. They can tell you different, but you won't hear it. And I'll tell you why. You want the glory of saying, I planted and I caused that garden to grow. Look what I did. As long as this is in your mind, you're interfering with your own life, with your own happiness. Again, you haven't had happiness because you're interfering and you won't see that fact. What is interference? Interference consists of the mechanical movement of thought, emotion, and even your physical self. Mechanical being unconscious. You know not what you're doing to yourself all day long because you don't slow down and see, and so you trample your own garden. Simplicity. Simplicity is what we seek, and it comes when you leave yourself alone. You see what you're doing to yourself? No, you don't. You trample yourself all day long and then have the nerve to blame someone else. And those other people who come over and trample the garden of your life, you invited them. They wouldn't come over there unless you went over and asked them in the first place, saying, I want some help. The help you ask from the other person and from your own low-level mind are exactly the same tragedy. Lack of insight and all the pride and the vanity of every human being wanting to say, see what I did. There's the world speaking. See what I did. I started that business and built it up to $1 million. I, with my own loveliness, attracted that man, and look what a fine husband and family I have. We make ourselves the center of our own life, and you cry all day and night. Now, it just so happens that there is something else in this world beside you. You don't know it yet. There is something beside you that when you join yourself with it, when you live from the the full facts of the book and stop interfering, all is well. It could happen right now by the clock, by about 10 minutes after 9 this morning. It could happen right now if you make your determination, you're never, ever again going to interfere with what truth is trying to do for you. Well, who knows more, you or God? If things go wrong, isn't it a pretty good suspicion to think that maybe we have a bit of conceit that thinks we know more than anyone else? There is a very rare beauty, and the word rare is quite right in this case, in which you can walk out of this hall, walk into a business organization, walk into your home, and walk out again, and nothing wrong has happened. Because you haven't interfered. You don't walk into a situation and say, I want that out of it. Where does this I want that come from? Well, it comes from way on back, doesn't it? An insecure person always says, I want so that I won't feel empty, right? And no matter how much he gets, he always has to repeat the same sentence over again. Why don't you stop uttering the sentence, I want? And just walk through the world as if you don't need anything from it, which is a fact. We're not talking about physical needs or social needs, things like that. Needs for company is fine. We have company here in this room. Try sometime sitting on the porch of your house and looking out at that garden and see that there is indeed something besides you that can operate. And when you see that there's something besides you that can operate, you'll see how foolish you've been all your life. How all your tears were simply a stage show. All your calls for help were simply an attempt to get someone into your life to make you feel better. You wanted the credit, of course, for anything that happened out in the garden. All those potatoes, you wanted to brag about it. Try sometimes sitting on the porch and watch life develop. And only when you're seated there as the watcher will it develop. Meddling. Interference. Remember the words, and you go out of here today and watch how you meddle with everything, and you're compelled to do it. You, as a matter of fact, it is so bad you can't stop yourself from interfering. There's no way you can. Your mind is going so fast, and your feelings and your wish to say something to someone. Try sometime not going over and talking to someone. Try sometime not talking to yourself and giving yourself all this very bad advice. How do we ever get through to ourselves that something exists, a growth factor, that something exists besides our attempts to make the world turn? Before you were born, was the world moving pretty much okay on its own? And then we come into it and we say, well, I guess I was put here to give it a push now and then. Our vanity talking, thinking, see, you don't care about the whole world. You care about your world, and that's the only world you have. So you're afraid that your little personal world will stop revolving, and you want it to revolve. You want it to spin madly every second to give you a dizzy ride. Because the dizzier your mind, the less you'll have to face the fact that that it is dizzy. If you slow it down a little bit, you can begin to compare. If your mind is going 1,000 miles an hour and you turn it down to 500 miles an hour, you can see the difference in the two paces, can't you? Have you ever had that experience? Haven't you ever looked at yourself and see a little bit difference in your behavior? This is where uniqueness comes in. A unique person who says, okay, my mind is going like mad all day long. I'm rushing around doing things, spending money foolishly, talking to people, trying to assure myself that I'm okay. I'll see what happens when I don't assure myself that I'm okay. Even saying that, even thinking that you must prove yourself in any way at all is all wrong. But try it. Sit back and say, all right, I'll bear the pain of not going over and trying to promote myself to that person by putting on an act of some kind. I'll bear the pain of not running madly through my mind all these plans I have for the future. I will bear the pain of letting my pain go. Do you know that every time you interfere with your pain, you keep it pain? You feel something dreadful inside of you, a shock, a stab of some kind. You feel it, and then you add to it by being afraid of it or by blaming someone else for making you feel bad. This heartache, someone else made me feel bad. So you've added to your own pain by feeling pain toward it. What would be the different state? If you're sitting on the porch and you're watching yourself this time instead of the garden, and you see the heartache, and you see the churning inside of you, who said you had to do anything about it? You tell me, who said you ever have to do anything about it? You're going to be baffled at trying to answer that question, aren't you? And you had better be baffled. You better find out that there's no one there at all, that any authority that said you have to sit there and suffer, do anything at all with it. If you sit and suffer, there's nothing you can do about it or should do about it, which is non-interference with agony. And I'll repeat. Anytime you make a move to push away the pain, the heartache, the loneliness, whatever it might be, every time you make a move, you keep it going. Because you are the center of everything. The disappearance of all effort to change yourself causes change to happen just as much as the garden grows all by itself. The world is utterly mad with its millions, and I mean millions, of personal and social schemes for making itself free and happy. And I'll tell you what the deception is and what a malicious deception it is. Human beings don't want to be free and happy. They want to talk about it. They don't want anything to interfere with the pleasure of their pain. How about you? If you want to walk out of here today, understanding everything we've talked about, you can walk out of here never having another single heartache over anything. You ladies want a man or you want to get rid of a man? You men want a woman or you want to get rid of a woman? What do you want? Find out what you want and find out how you're interfering with yourself. When will we get through our heads that there's an intelligence greater than mine or yours? It always comes back to the same point. What are you going to give up? What are you going to sacrifice? Are you going to sacrifice your belief that you can and must save yourself? The fact that you even think that there's someone to rescue is the first mistake. If you will go through the ultimate final shock of seeing that there's no one there to be saved, you will be. Do you understand that? Or did the airplane go out of sight? That is that too much for you to see? You can't think about it. Remember that rule. You can't think about higher spiritual truths. You've got to see them. And if you try to think of them, that will be interference with the insight. Don't be afraid. I'm going to say this in several ways now. Don't be afraid to let go of yourself. Have no hesitation in dissolving your ordinary thoughts about yourself and about life. Be very free and very bold to just walk through your day without anxiety, which would be the same thing as being without your usual self ideas. Go through your day just as if you have it made in the highest way. You do in the timeless state. You do in reality. You have it made because truth has it made and is always had it made 50 billion years ago and 50 billion years from now. Truth has it made because it is what it is. But we are not what we really are. We've added something to it. We've added the colored water and the sawdust on the garden. and added all these other foolish things, all simply because we don't know any better, and here we're learning better. Don't you listen to yourself anymore. You've given yourself such horrible advice and have trampled the garden. You stop listening to what you've been listening to all your life, but for about the third time during this talk alone, real honestly now, what has been the outcome of you listening to your own counsel? Of you listening to yourself and saying, I know what I should do. If you knew what to do, how come it drives you crazy? You know what to do, but you don't see what it's doing against you. All this amounts to letting go, and we'll do it now. Letting go of the mad pace of the thoughts, of thinking that you have to save yourself. Who must you save yourself from? Only one thing. Your ignorance. Your false beliefs, our vanities and our conceits. That here's what we say. Well, if I don't have the answer, where am I going to get it? See, you won't let go and say, you won't let go. You don't have the courage to let go and say, I don't have the answer, period. Any of you in this room and listening to the talk who will say, I don't know, stop right there, period, the answer will come to you. But you always add something, don't you? You interfere. I don't know, period. Therefore, I will read 5 more books. I don't know, therefore I will ask someone. I don't know, therefore I will go into entertainment, into pleasure, and maybe that will push away the pain of not knowing. When you say, I don't know, when you really say it, and there's a period after it, you stop right there, that's the ending of ordinary, conditioned, harmful thought. And at that point, when there's no thought there at all, then this higher power, what do you want to call it, God, truth, this comes in and shows you every answer to every problem you've ever had, including the problem of how can I save myself? And the answer is, there is no one there to be saved. All the time you're thinking this, right now as I'm talking to you, you really think, I know you do. You're not kidding me by nodding your head. I know that you actually think, there is someone seated here who must be saved. I know better. And you listen to what I'm telling you instead of your own neurotic mind. Because if you do, you're going to go out of here the same way you came in. I know that you don't exist as someone who needs to be saved. And I know if you can see through this, then the whole idea of salvation takes on a different meaning. And you know what that meaning is, perhaps. It means to save yourself from ignorance. From thinking that there's someone there who must be protected, someone there who must be promoted, someone there who must be sad if necessary. Ah, that's a good refuge. I'll be sad, I'll be lonely, but at least I'm here. Oh, no, you are not. And you stop kidding yourself. Stop kidding yourself thinking that anything you do can prove your existence, because you can't. You can't prove that a delusion is true. And all your pain and your struggling and your nervousness and your insecurity is caused by you trying to prove that a lie is the truth. Impossible. All right, apply as we come to a close here in a little bit. Apply the idea of non-interference, of simply leaving everything alone. Apply it from now on to your life. You catch yourself thinking some kind of a thought that is harmful, that's shaky. Say that's interference. Interference is something that's unnecessary, and you tell me. You tell me if being nervous and afraid is necessary. It's necessary to keep your false state going. Of course, we're talking about something higher. Truth knows what is needless for you, what is unnecessary.